Well, thank you, Dick. It's great to see you again. And it's not often I get to share the stage with some of the folks who were so generous in sharing their stories in the book, so I'm delighted to have you with us this morning. And thank you again for your generosity, because the work that is chronicled in the book wouldn't have been possible without your generosity of sharing. So,
it was a pleasure.
Well, I'm sure many people know the story of kind of Amway AltaCorp as it began. I thought maybe it would be a good place to start to have you just share a little bit about your first memories of the business growing up, and then kind of how your path led into the business in that.
Sure. Well, Andrew, it was really a pleasure working with you on the book. It was, anytime anybody asks you to do something like that where you have to be reflective, it's sort of like this morning, you may learn something, but and I hope that something that's encouraging or inspiring comes out of our conversation for you. But anytime I go through and have to be introspective, I know I remember things and remind myself of things, and I learn stuff. So thank you for giving me a learning opportunity here. And Andrew's book was another one of those opportunities. We had some great conversations on the phone and talked about these issues. And Andrew had great questions, and it promoted some really important reflection for me in my own life. So thank you for that opportunity. And for everybody here, this is really a unique distinctive of West Michigan, in my view. I've done some things in life okay, and I've done some things in life that didn't turn out exactly what I expected. So I'm clearly not a politician. And but while I was in that phase of my life, I had the opportunity to look at and visit, in fact, every county in Michigan and enormous numbers of communities across our state. And it really reminded me of the uniqueness of the environment we have here in West Michigan, and that's because of a lot of the families and individuals in this room. The fact that we have so many family businesses, and that's part of it, but I think you have to look at beyond and say, well, family business, that's sort of easy to throw out. But what does that mean? That means that the management and the shareholders of these, of your organizations, take a very different view about their role, take a different view about community, because the management and the shareholders tend to live in this community, stay in this community, are a part of this community. And as a consequence, it just changes the engagement, it changes the game. And when I look at other communities, and I just compare and contrast, I mean, we could talk all morning about compare and contrast between West Michigan and East Michigan, because I felt like every time I was going across 75 on the campaign, I was going through the DMZ into a whole different world. Because East Michigan's a very different world. Corporate leadership there tends to be transactional and transitional. These are large public companies. Their shareholders are widely dispersed. Their view of the community engagement is very, very different than it is here, and their worldview is very, very different. And as a consequence, I think we see the ultimate differences between the communities. So these conversations are really, really important, not just for your businesses, but this is a critical a uniqueness in our community. And finally, I would just say, too, that in addition to family business, there's another characteristic here is entrepreneurship. And I hope that each of you in your respective businesses will keep that spark of entrepreneurship alive, that spark of innovation. And there's a reference, and Bruce mentioned earlier about Art Prize, some people think Art Prize is just about art, but Art Prize is about art, which is also about creativity, which is also about innovation, which is also about entrepreneurship. So with Art Prize, we are, I hope, and I believe Rick hopes too, that we're rekindling a spark of entrepreneurship and creativity and seeing and thinking in brand new ways about what we need to do within our respective organizations to be difference makers in the future. So if you see Art Prize, it's not about art. I'd encourage you, every time Art Prize comes around, it's a reminder to you to think in a new way about your business, to think in a new way about the way you're doing things, to think in a new way about the way you're approaching issues that might exist within your respective families. Because Art Prize is a reminder to us to be creative and to remain entrepreneurial. That's if we're going to make it as a community and as businesses, we are not going to be the same in 10 years that we are today. Mm-hmm. So I hope you'll use Art Prize as an annual reminder to think about your business, not just think about art. You can do that too. Walk around the street and do that too. But think about your business and your family in a new way every year, and do that, maybe it helps. So, Andrew, you want me to go back to the question now? I feel like I'm on a debate. This is a debate format. You ask me a question, I completely ignore it, and then and give my three message points, and then two of which are possibly not exactly accurate, and then away we go. In my case, I think my message points were pretty on track so far. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well,
give me the truth meter. Give me the truth meter.
They're feeding into questions that are coming up, so it's great.
My background, and how many, by the way, how many in this room are G2? Okay, so G2s, we'll kind of get this, but there's two different views of G2s, right? There's the view that, well, of course, everything was going to work out for you. You know, this is the way it happens. You know. Your parents set it up, and then all you have to do is wake up in the morning and take a breath, and your life just happens beautifully. Isn't that the way it's been working for y'all? G3s, by the way, that's not the way it is. Your experience is different. The G2 experience is growing up in a entrepreneurial business is a very different experience typically than the G3 experience. And my experience, I think, was similar. There's an assumption, and I certainly heard about this, regularly during the campaign discussion some years ago. That I was clearly born with a silver spoon in my mouth, and that everything in life was sort of just automatically blessed as a consequence, and that it took nothing but just showing up and breathing, and that's very different than the experience I had. I grew up in a very normal home. Out in Ada, when it was kind of a more country than suburban, and it wasn't even clear to me that my parents were that my parents' financial situation or circumstance was materially different than the kids at the little Ada public school that I went to. That was much different than the kids from the farms and the surrounding community that I grew up with that were my friends. It wasn't really very, very clear till high school that the situation was much different. I'd walk to school, and life was quite normal. So automatically, that's a little bit different from sort of the operative assumptions about the fact that everything was silver platter and everything was very clear. And then the other interesting dynamic that is sometimes overlooked in the community about the Amway business is that the Amway business, actually, there were two families involved. And by the way, they're not related. I get this all the time, right? They said, oh, your brother, Steve Van Andel? No, I like Steve a lot. He's a good friend. He's not my brother. Different gene pool, different DNA. And in fact, that became rather apparent later in life as my father and Jay, as time went by, their differences in worldview became more apparent. And as particularly as it related to transition, we can talk about that. So it's a very much a two-family business with two very distinctly different families involved, and that creates some very interesting dynamics. One of which is that it tends to put you into a situation where there's a little bit more expectation, there's a little bit more of a meritocracy required. When you've got another family looking at you, that sets up a somewhat different dynamic. So I used to have that when I was president there for 10 years, I have other CEOs who ran public companies would say to me, "Well, Dick, it must be easier for you." I said, "Because when you walk into the boardroom, you know, you don't have to deal with analysts, you don't have to deal with outside board members. You just have to deal with people you know." I said, "Well, let me explain to you how the boardroom works. Half the room is the DeVos family, half the room is the Vandal family. So half the room doesn't trust me because they're not related to me. The other half doesn't trust me because they are related to me." They said, "Oh, I hadn't thought about it that way."
So one of the things you said in the book was, "I may have been born on third base, but I learned to hit triples." And I think it speaks to what you were talking about. There's this assumption that you're kind of born with the silver spoon in your mouth. So how was it as a next generation member that you earned your credibility with the employees, with the Van Andel family, with your own family? How did you go about earning that credibility?
Well, I think for G2, it's a little more intuitive, and this is, I think, a special challenge, maybe even more so for G3, if the business is doing well, and then because the expectations are a little bit more set. I think most of you have probably heard the expression, right? Born on third base and thought he hit a triple. And I really tried to be conscious of the fact that one of my challenges was to earn my way to third base and not just make any assumptions. So my first experience at Amway, I took a circuitous route through college. I actually went to college for a short time, went to Calvin College until the dean of students called me one day and said, "Dick, if you stay enrolled here for two more days, these grades will become a part of your permanent record. But if you leave now, they will evaporate like a mist." The decision was obvious at that point. I went back and ultimately finished my degree at Northwood University. But so I got in the. I started in the business early on, and there was no clear path to the basket for what the future was going to be, and ultimately. I ended up leaving the company for a short time after having run the international side of the business. But I left the company, and it's just because there was no clear path at that point. One of the things that they put in place that my father and Mr. Van Andel put in place that I think was very good was that they put in place a training program, and that program forced everyone in the family that wanted to be a part of the business to actually go out and to work in different parts of the company. And so by the time I was starting to move within management and leadership there, I had an existing relationship and I think at least grudging respect from the people that I'd worked with, many of whom I had screwed on bottle caps with or worked in laboratories with or, sat next to in the accounting areas, the numerous positions across that I'd worked with and developed relationships and earned a certain amount of respect. And I guess it all kind of came together in one. I remember very well. I must have been a little bit tired or a little short, but Amway was during my time there as CEO again. We would bring in journalists from outside the United States, and one journalist asked a question and said, of course you're president of the company because your father is one of the founders and you're the eldest son. So that was obvious you were going to become president of the company, yes? And I said, no. I said, first of all, the fact that my father is one of the founders did give me visibility inside the company more than others. But the reason so that was certainly a contributing factor. But the reason that I'm president of this company right now is because I'm damn good at what I do. Thank you very much. Next question. And I realized afterwards it was the ability to say that and with a sense that I was there because I was good at what I did and that I'd earned that right. And that I had paid the price. And yes, I did have some tailwind along the way, to be sure. but it was showing up every day and making a difference, and trying to be do my part and then just a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. So when did you first kind of come to the realization that you had an aspiration to run the company, and how did you approach leveraging your own strengths as you led towards that?
Well, my father and Jay were towering personalities, very different personalities. And my father was very visible, very gregarious, very outgoing, very outspoken. If you put him on the introvert extrovert 10 scale, he's a 12 on the extrovert side, right? And many of you have either known him or heard about him, and I hover a lot more toward the middle of that introvert extrovert scale. I work in a different place. So it became clear to me that my role and path at the company was going to be very, very different than my father's, because I didn't have the skill set that he had, which was uniquely necessary for the success of the business. Mm-hmm. My father and I have reflected on it and have had various conversations there's no way that my skill set would have been able to create this remarkable enterprise. But during the time that I was involved in leadership there, both on the international side and ultimately globally, I had to do some things that he acknowledges there was no way he could have done because of history and relationship and perspective that were significant to the success of the business. And so we've looked back and said, we brought very different skill sets that were both at the appropriate time really, really necessary for the business.
Do you have a kind of story about one of those things that you kind of realized you had to change that maybe your father wouldn't have had the energy or the skill set to change?
I think the biggest, we had to go through a period of significant transformation shortly after I became president of the company, and I got two examples. That one and maybe another one. But the company was facing some financial pressures, competitive pressures, and financial pressures. Performance was moving down. Our efficiencies internally had been moving up. That there had become a developed sort of entitlement mentality inside the organization. Everything had gone pretty well. The problem in businesses, probably everywhere in life, is that if you have a pretty good run, you actually start to convince yourself that you are smarter than the average bear, and that's a dangerous place to be. Better to be hungry than mm-hmm. to think you're smarter than the rest. Well, we'd kind of been led into that corner. We had people who'd been with our organization for many, many years who had made contributions, but whose contributions were no longer, were a part of our past, not going to be a part of our future. So how do you navigate those? And so I had the privilege of recognizing that and leading through a transformation that resulted in us reducing our workforce within a very short period of time by some 1,100 or 1,200 positions. Some of you may have read about that. That was both, it was the best and worst of times. Intellectually, very challenging, and to go through a transformation of an organization like that, when you look back on it, is very, you learn so much. But emotionally enormously difficult when you have to have these very difficult conversations with people who had been a part of your life for many, many years. And my father, he acknowledges, and I think Mr. Van Andel acknowledged too, there's just no way that they could have done that. But when it became clear that it was either going to be those positions, and this is, I don't think it's hyperbole, that either we were going to make those changes, both in position, but also we made changes in structure. We didn't just cut the organization this way, by the way. We didn't just lop off, you know, some 1,200 jobs at the bottom of the organization, which is I think the cheap and easy way out, and the wrong way in our case, anyway. We cut the organization, we cut it vertically, and we took out positions all the way up and down the organization. We had to deal with it with regard to people who had been with us for many, many years, and tried to deal with each situation honorably. And I'm pleased to say that having gone through that, we had zero wrongful discharge lawsuits. We had zero issues because we tried to deal honorably with each individual as best we could. But when it became necessary, or when it became clear to me that it was either going to be that kind of massive restructure or the entire totality of the business was going to be at risk, that decision became very clear.
Mm-hmm. So how did you maintain your compass? Because I'm in that situation, because I'm sure there were plenty of people in the community and the press and that would cry foul about laying off people. It creates a lot of emotional angst. How did you kind of maintain your rudder?
I think it's for me, it was going back to that larger picture. For those of us in leadership, you know, we've got to constantly, in my view, be fighting to expand our field of view. Because it's so easy for our field of view to get narrowed. I think that's just normal for us as human beings. So we've got to constantly be pushing out the field of view to see that larger picture and to see the larger either opportunity or responsibility. And it was that larger picture that helped me to stay focused. And then you just simply have to have the gumption and the courage as a leader to do what you believe is right at the end of the day and be accountable for that decision. And ultimately I was accountable for that decision. Some would suggest that decision to do that was one of the reasons that I was unable to be successful in politics, was because I was the heartless business person that took out 1,200 jobs. Nobody spoke to the fact that maybe I saved 10,000. Mm-hmm. That wasn't a part of the dialogue. But that was the reality I had to constantly stay focused on. Was the reality of what we were saving. Why were we doing this? Why was it the right thing? And then I had to reconcile that with, as I say, being honorable about treating those that were leaving our organization, because I felt it was it was critically, critically important how we treated everyone that left. Because whenever you do go through those times, and I'm sure many of you have been through those, when you do that, absolutely everybody in the organization has sort of the same reaction, which is about those who are leaving. I said, but it's there, but by the grace of God, go I. Does this company value me? And I'm going to measure that by how they value her. And so I thought it was really, really important. And we had to have a lot of conversation with some old school thinkers inside our organization. Some of them, one of them may have been my father.
Old school thinker?
about how generous we were with making sure that we did the right thing by people. Mm-hmm. And I believe he would sit here today if you asked him about that experience, and he would tell you it's the best money we ever spent. It was the best thing we ever did, because it allowed for us to heal both personally and culturally, organizationally. It allowed us to heal because we knew we had done everything we could do to help these great people who just didn't have a place in our organization, but we're going to find a place somewhere else, and we were going to help them do that too. So it helped us heal, and it helped the organization heal far more rapidly.
So you kind of referenced the old school versus new school. I think it's a dilemma that a lot of next generation members run into with their parents. How did you navigate that conversation with your father when you knew certain things needed to change and deal with the friction that often happens between father and son in those situations?
Yeah, well, I was really, my father, despite, occasional disagreements, is a enormously trusting and encouraging guy, and is not by nature controlling. So mm-hmm. That's a huge gift. And if you're G1, you are probably by nature controlling. To about the 98th percentile, would that be your?
Yeah, I would say that jives with my research.
Yeah. You do your G2 such an enormous gift if you can acknowledge that and have that honest conversation. My father had clear opinions, but he also was open to listen to a different way of thinking and a different point of view, and that was a huge gift. That was a huge gift. Yeah, we disagreed. We had we'd have lots of conversations, but. He ultimately trusted me that this was the right thing to do, and oftentimes my idea prevailed. Oftentimes it didn't, mm-hmm. And it was both with my father and Mr. Van Andel, and sometimes I was right and sometimes I was wrong. Mm-hmm. But we had a great conversation about it. There was never the. Neither one ever played the dad card, mm-hmm. Okay, thanks very much, but we're just gonna, but I'm still in charge here. We're going to do it my way. Mm-hmm. That's enormously destructive in my view. And so we were able to have a good dialogue, and that was meaningful.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you kind of referenced failure a little bit there. I think. One of the dangers in family business is we often tell the stories of our great successes, then success becomes magical because in order to be successful, you can't fail.
Right.
But yet, all of those successes really were built on failures across time. How did you experience failure, and how did that influence your development as a next generation member?
Well, failure in our culture. In our family culture and in the Amway business culture and the Amway story, failure was a recurrent conversation, which was really, really healthy. My father, he was just over at dinner. We had some friends over for dinner last night from out of town, and we're sitting at different tables. My father and mother were sitting at one table. Betsy and I weren't there, and everybody at the table reported how much they enjoyed him regaling them with stories of all his business failures prior to Amway. Beginning with sinking a boat, they bought a sailboat and then sunk it just off Cuba. Didn't intentionally sink it for the insurance adjusters in the room. But it started off with a funny story of trying to sail to South America and never quite making it, to starting an import business and never quite making it, to a health food business that never quite made it. So the idea of failure and persevering through failure was a part of the DNA and the culture of the business. And so that was a healthier conversation, mm-hmm. within our world. I think the other healthy conversation was, my parents were very articulate, I think, and encouraging about being the best we could be, utilizing all of our God-given talents, mm-hmm. and gifts, wherever that took us. And that their mantra was, be your best, do your best, make a contribution, make a difference. That may be here and it may be there. Now, everybody in family business knows that underneath that statement is, but I'd still really like you to come in the family business. Right. But at least they gave voice to and were open to the idea of doing other things and still challenging everyone to be their very best, teacher, preacher, or business.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. And when you had to earn credibility coming out of you know, maybe one of the failures that, that you experienced as you were kind of moving up through the organization. How did you get up and dust yourself off and kind of re-engage? Because I'm sure I like to say that in a family business, your successes are always compared to those that went before you, but your failures are always yours as an individual.
Yeah, it's sort of like failures in a family business are sort of like friends, you know. Yeah. Friends come and go, but enemies accumulate. And yeah, failure in a family business is oftentimes, as you say, becomes a strike against you as opposed to a strike in your favor. That's really unhealthy. There were a number of things that didn't happen particularly well in business. I mean, I was responsible for the Amway business in China for initially kicking it off, and then I left the company and for a few years, and then came back, and China was growing and has now become the largest segment of Amway's business globally. But in the course of those early years, the China business was shut down twice by the Chinese government because of controversy about the business model and how that was all going to work within the context of what was acceptable to the Chinese leadership. And so we had to go through some bumpy times to try to figure those things out. Not everybody agreed with some of the changes that we had to make during the management restructuring that I spoke about, and it resulted in some family members leaving the company, which doesn't make for great Thanksgiving dinner conversation on average. I think again, back to widening the field of view, and okay. That didn't work out. What did we learn? Mm-hmm. What can we do better? What did I learn from this? What can I do better?
Gotcha. Now, not many next generation members have the courage to kind of leave the company for a period of time, but it's one of the themes that with many of the successors that I talked about in writing the book was that they felt that I am in charge of my own career path, and if I don't see a path here, I will pursue that. What did you learn when you left, and what drew you back?
Leaving the company was wonderful because I learned that I'd be okay. It's so easy for us to start self-identifying with an organization or with our role or an organization or our particular role with a family, and so it was really, very gratifying and affirming. Your friends were still your friends. Your associates still returned your phone calls. And I think that was enormously empowering for me to go through that, just on a human scale, it's gonna be all right. And I can make a difference, and I can contribute, and so that break resulted in some community involvement for me that I wasn't able to do before. It has been enormously meaningful to me over the years. So I think that break is good. And by the way, I really recommend, and we have a policy internally at Amway now, and within our family as well, in our family office operations, that before a family member can come and join our any family business enterprise, that you have to go outside and work elsewhere outside the family business. You can't just simply come from college directly into the family business. And if you don't have that ethos within your organization, I'd strongly encourage it, because I wish, I wish I'd frankly had that experience earlier in my career as opposed to later in my career. Because there's nothing more empowering than the ability and the confidence to be able to say, to know in your heart that if it's time, I'm out of here. I don't have to put up with this stuff. See you later. And I went through that period and had a hard conversation with my father. I said, "You ever? You know, I can't. The path was not clear. The way forward was not clear. I had other. You know, if it's not clear where my future is going to be here, then I'm going to go make my future elsewhere." And had that conversation with him. I'll come back and help if the family ever calls, and I'll drop everything and I'll be here. But I can't stay here anymore. And was very, I think, a very important time for me. Mm-hmm. I encourage it early in life so that every family member in the organization has that kind of confidence. And I think it's, you want that kind of confidence and independence. You want them to be able to feel that they can walk and be just fine. They're gonna be so much better in your organization as a result.
So what drew you back after getting that?
In my case, it was my father's health. My father's had a series of health issues. I'm 60, and right now my father had his first heart bypass surgery at age 58. So you kind of get mindful of those things. He had health issues for many years, and had. He was starting to feel some more symptoms after his bypass surgery, came back strong for a number of years, but he was starting to demonstrate a pattern of health challenge, and so the family circled around and said, "Dad, it's time for you to back up," and approached me at that point and asked if I would step in and succeed him. And so that whole deal was cut with my family, was cut with the Van Andel family, for me to step in, for my father to step aside. That was all done, and we were actually just working on the public announcement of that transition when he had a massive heart attack that resulted in his ending up in Cleveland Clinic, which ended up then ultimately with a heart transplant. So it was really as a result of a health crisis that brought me back, and I tried to be true to my word. If my family said they wanted me to come back, I would.
Gotcha. And for the G1s in the room, what did your father do that was helpful to your growth and development? What maybe got in the way of your growth and development as a successor?
I think my father was tremendously encouraging and trusting, and that was enormously empowering to me. That he had the capacity, and I don't know that I have the same capacity to be self-deprecating and to be tremendously encouraging of others. And I'm really trying to develop that in myself with my own children as well. To be that kind of an encouragement and a supporter, and change my role from that of parent to coach and counselor, mm-hmm. and advisor and hopefully confidant, from boss or from the hierarchy, from a system of a vertical relationship to a more horizontal relationship, and I think, you know, in a weird way, my father's health helped to contribute to that substantially. So his physical inability to engage on some things allowed for that relationship to happen, you know, mm-hmm. maybe more rapidly as a consequence. But if you're G1, to be that kind of an encourager, to be an empower, to be trusting, to be willing to let some things happen differently than the way you would have done them, to accept the fact that there may be two right answers to things. I know that for G1s, that's a really difficult concept to understand, that there might be two right answers. And none of the G1s even laughed about that. They said, "What is he talking about? How can there be two right answers?" But to accept that possibility that there are two right answers and different ways to do things would be really empowering.
Great. So one last question before I open it up for a few questions from the floor. So we just heard some advice for the older generation. What's your advice for the next generation in terms of how they can step up and prepare themselves for leadership?
Well, I guess for the G2 in the crowd, if your role in life is to be a G2, I encourage you to not expect the world to applaud you. Don't expect your family to applaud you, because what'll happen, you're the salami in the sandwich. The G1 will typically think you're trying to take all his or her money in control, and the G3s will think that you're trying to take all their money in control too. So you're kind of screwed no matter what you do on this thing. So don't expect, and the public's going to think that it's a cakewalk, right? That you just fell in the soup, and you know, lucky sperm club, as they say. So, you know, so nobody's really going to have much sympathy for you, right? That famous expression from a movie that I'm an aviator and I fly my own jet aircraft. So my friends oftentimes quote to me. I said, "Oh yeah, Dick, right? But nobody's sorry for a guy who has a private jet." So, fair enough. So G2, get over it. This is our lot in life. And just execute it honorably. And establish, your challenge is going to be to establish, in my view, just opinion, to establish the governance systems and structures within your family that will be enduring. And that's going to be your role, and nobody outside your family will appreciate it, and nobody inside your family will appreciate it until later on. But that's your challenge, is to figure out how do you do this enduring structures. G1 won't understand it. This is their baby. I was going to go back to another thing too that was very empowering. My father said, by the way, but he made a statement one time that was very impactful. He said, "The Amway business is not my legacy. My real, true legacy is my family and my children." That's powerful. When someone has built this enormous enterprise and poured themselves into that, and they turn right to you and say, no, this is important, but you're my legacy. So G1s, if you can, in your heart, say that and mean it, really, really important. So G2, that's your role. I think G3 is really going to be a matter of earning your stripes, and boy, do everything you can to accumulate experience. And I would really strongly encourage outside experience. If you can't leave the company, to get outside experience, do everything you can to get engaged in other places, in other worlds, be it community or community organizations or otherwise. Gain all the experience that you can external to your business. If your business allows for you to even take a sabbatical to go do something and go work somewhere or go build something or go to another project, anything you can do to accumulate some outside experience and perspective, I think will be tremendously helpful to you in coming back and earning your stripes and being accepted in your organizations for who you are and the talent that you bring that will probably be quite unique from your grandparents or your parents.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, we have some time for question and answer. So if you have a question for Dick, please raise your hand and stand up and we got a question right here. So just to repeat the question for everybody, the question is, how do you balance the need for technical skills with the need for passion in the next generation?
I don't think there's any substitute for passion. And if your family leadership and your family members don't have passion, then you may need to look elsewhere for the leadership for the family enterprise. I just don't think there's a substitute. People will see through a lack of passion. And the whole organization, and it's just, it'll be corrosive in my view. Technical skills, absolutely. So family members, if they still want to be a part of the family business and contribute at their level and do that, that's great, but you have to figure out how to help them find a role or find their way out to another role where they can find some passion. And if they don't have passion about being in the family business, I'd be doing everything I could to counsel them out. Go find your passion. If it's not here, find it. What a miserable frickin' life, you know? To go through life without passion in your work. We spend so much time in our work. Find a way to do that. And then be really, really careful, of course, that you don't, that you find ways that they can be rewarded for still as being a part of the family, so that the financial incentives to stay inside the business don't become so overwhelming that you trap people into a really corrosive environment. Find ways that you're not financially trapping them, and that if they do leave, then other mitigating systems that if they do leave, that they still have enough connectivity and information so that you don't create an insider-outsider dynamic as well. So that there's sufficient transparency, sufficient information, and sufficient financial sharing as a member of the family, they have the freedom to be able to go, and then you find those with passion to lead the business. The business nor the family will be well served if the business fails.
Thank you. Other questions? Regina. How does G1 know when it's time to exit? Inquiring minds want to know.
Boy. Every family is different. Every business is different. Let me start there. There's no right answer in a family business, which is why this is a really, really great place for consultants to be. It's a wonderful space. There's room for lots of them because there's lots of answers out there. Best done. It's not an event. It's a process. It's a course of conversation, and it's probably, on average, going to be sooner than G1 thinks and later than G2 thinks. Because G2 is going to be, it's going to be, have all the answers, at a point in their life. And are going to feel frustrated. But as long as there's a path forward, as long as there's a conversation, if there is, we're working on this together, we're going to get there, and here's what here's what you need to do to prepare yourself, and here's what I need to do to prepare myself as G1. And then the other thing is that sooner the better, sooner than you want, probably, from a G1 perspective, because good Lord only knows what happens in life, and second, if there's bumps in the road or somehow that doesn't work, you don't want it to be at the end of the road. You'd like to be able to kind of recover it. You'd like to be able to engage with it. You'd like to be able to have a little time on the back end to extend it. And if you wait too long, then that can become maybe a little bit problematic too. For G1s, the other challenge, I think, for G1s is developing a second passion. For a lot of G1s that I've become associated with, they were so, their business was truly their, the business was their passion. It was all-consuming. It was their, and many of them didn't develop another passion that would fulfill that. And so the void on the other side made it very, very difficult to move out of what they knew. And so I think the dynamic for G1s is to really be articulate, to be intentional about creating an alternative possibility and something, finding something that you can truly get excited about to pour yourself into, so that when that time does come, there's a feeling of I'm moving towards something, not I'm moving away from something else. Much more encouraging for us as human beings, I think, if we're moving towards something than if we're moving away from something. So there's something to move toward, and then start going and engage that process sooner versus later.
Yeah. There's a saying in our world that golf and travel last 6 months, so you better have something meaningful that you're moving towards if you want to kind of avoid that trap of being pulled back in. Other questions? So the question was balancing relationships with siblings who you may or may not have been in the business at the same time, and how you're thinking about cousins and cousins relationships.
Yeah, that sibling to cousin transition, we're really trying to think about that very much within our own family, because we as a family have on two levels. We have an Amway business enterprise that we're working on with another family. We have a variety of enterprises that we are involved with as a family as well, that are wholly a part of our family world. And so we're thinking about that. We've developed within the DeVos family, it's probably more developed scenario, so it's maybe easier to talk about that. But we actually have a multi-generational committee. Representative, my mother's on the committee. We have G2 and G3, what we call a lifelong learning committee. And that really talks about learning and teaching and developing and conversation. It's putting together forums and opportunities for cousins to come together to develop bonds and relationships and shared learning possibilities. Each one is developing life plans. We're putting together what are requirements for various levels of participation within our family. What do you need to do? What are the sort of skills that you need to accumulate if you wish to rise to layers of leadership within the family or within business enterprise? What are the sort of things that you need to be thinking about? We've brought in some outside help to do that and have those sometimes challenging conversations. I think the other thing we've talked about a lot is that I think has been helpful to me anyway, has been the metaphor of hats, and just being really mindful of what hat we're wearing and at what time. And we talk about this, Betsy and I talk about this a lot with our kids and very openly with our kids. You know, what hat do we have on? Do we have the dad hat on? Do we have the boss hat on? Do we have the business advisor hat on? What do we have the son or daughter hat on? Do we have the business leader hat on, who happens to be son or daughter? And really try to be articulate about what role are we in today, so that informs our conversation. And that was really, really helpful to be very articulate about that during my time at Amway, to go back to that, because I had siblings who reported to me. And we both had to understand that it was very different on the Wednesday before Thanksgiving in a business meeting than it was at the Thanksgiving table. That my role and responsibility as president was very different on the Wednesday than it was to be a brother on Thursday. And if I was a CEO on Thursday, I was, you know, shame on me. And if I was a brother on Wednesday, shame on me, right? But once we understood the hat, that was very, very helpful. And we talk about it, we try to challenge each other. I say, so what is this conversation? What are we having? What is this? You know, is this a father-daughter? Is this, what kind of conversation are we having here, so that we can be articulate about that conversation? And then be also very intentional about development of skills amongst the cousin generation, both skills and relationships amongst the cousin generation, to help them be prepared for the governance roles that they're going to have and the shared responsibility they're going to have going forward.
What's the most critical factor? Not to have a big question or not. What's the one key
Dick? I'll go back to my prior answer. Everyone's different. Communication, open and honest communication would be my first answer, and we've certainly not always demonstrated that very well. I won't ask you to raise your hands, but we in our family, at the both my nuclear family and I'll sweep the Van Andel family into the same thing, tend to be conflict averse. Now, some families maybe thrive on conflict, but I find a lot of family businesses are conflict averse, and they're not able to have and engage, kind of really honest, honest conversation, honest communication within the family structures. And if you can find ways to facilitate that through third party help, which has been enormously beneficial to our family to have third parties come in and be part of those conversations to help guide them and encourage for really honest, thoughtful communication, that was a big deal. And then trust, that we may have different answers, but that we were trusting each other's motives. And I think if you trust each other's motives, then you can deal with the differences so much easier. But if there's not trust, there fundamentally, that kind of all falls apart. So if you don't have trust, then within the family, between the generations, I'd get to work real fast on addressing and unpacking and trying to build that. The expression I like very much is, a formula: trust equals consistency over time. And keep that formula in mind. I found that to be, to be helpful as well. Those would be my two thoughts. There's probably, there's probably many other answers. Those come to my mind.
Great. Well, Dick, thank you for being so open and sharing your story. And please join me in thanking Dick.
Well, thanks, Andy. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
Good to see you again. Hopefully, got what you're looking for.
Yeah. Thank you.